Hey everybody, how's it going today? Welcome back. This is part two of installing Core Moto steel braided brake lines on my 2008 Ninja 250R track bike, and also rebuilding the front master cylinder. Just to catch up for anyone that doesn't remember or didn't watch the first video, I bought a set of steel braided brake lines from Core Moto for this bike, and I was in the process of installing them when I was having trouble bleeding the front brake. I come to realize that the master cylinder had an issue, and in taking it apart, we found out that the sight glass was cracked through, so that it was letting air into the master cylinder, as well as the piston, seals on the piston inside the master cylinder were chewed up. So I have since bought the parts necessary to rebuild that master cylinder. So we're going to move forward today with doing that, and then hopefully finishing up installing the front and then the rear brake lines. So why don't we get started, and let's see what happens. So here, as a reminder, it's the front master cylinder. You can see that crack running right through the sight glass right there, and actually it's completely through. It's not just a on the face of it, so it's letting, maybe can you see it in there, maybe not, it's letting air in. And then also when taking the plunger out, can you see right over here, that is completely chewed up. Let me shed a little light on that situation. See how that's chewed up right there? Yeah, as I was bleeding it, I kept seeing this black stuff coming into the master cylinder, and I thought it was paint, because I just kind of had poured brake fluid all over everything. Don't do that, by the way. But it just wasn't making sense, and I'm pretty sure that it was the rubber coming off of this and weeping through the hole right there. So I have gone ahead and I purchased on eBay, but it's a Parts Unlimited part, a complete rebuild kit for the master cylinder, which comes with a new piston, the two seals, spring, circlip, and the dust shield that sits in the front here. So that's good. So it's going to replace all of this stuff. And then I also ordered a brand new sight glass, which comes with an O-ring. Now this is a generic part. In looking for a part number for this on Kawasaki.com, that link will be below, as well as links for these parts here. There's no part number for just the sight glass, but so I just went into eBay, which I do a lot of shopping there, and I just typed in 2008 Kawasaki 250R master cylinder sight glass, and then a whole bunch of items popped up, and they were all listed as 18 millimeter. And in doing some quick and dirty measurements, it looks to be correct. And I believe too, this will work on many different machines. What you basically have is an acrylic sight glass, and then this metal flange around the edge. And again, you have your O-ring there. All right, so let's get to replacing that first. Actually, I want to pop that out and then clean this thing up a little bit, and then we'll replace the sight glass, and then we'll move on to the master cylinder plunger. All right, let me set you up on the tripod and we'll go from there. By the way, for some odd reason, when ordering this, you could only buy them in sets of two or four for some reason. I guess for shops, you know, I don't know. But I bought these, I got four of them ultimately, because I was thought, hey, maybe if I screw up, no pressure, right? So I bought these four for the same as price for two from all the other sales I saw. So yeah, that's what all this is. Oh, and by the way, I ended up getting a brand new set of front brake pads too, so we'll be installing those as well. first things first, let's set you up and get to it. All right, so here we go. I've got the master cylinder clamped in my vise. Mind you, these are aluminum inserts. I'm not putting too much pressure on here. I also don't want to mar it, so I'm careful. You know, somewhere I have rubber inserts. I just can't find them. Anyway, so in here is the sight glass. I'm going to use this 8mm socket and just sit it on top of the... it fits right inside that hole on this side of that sight glass. This is going to be a little tricky. Can I do it? I did it. There it is. And then I'm going to use a screwdriver and I'm going to cover it with some cloth because I don't want to gouge the inside of the master cylinder. Although in the end it really wouldn't matter that much, but still don't want to do it. And then I'm just going to put some pressure on it to push that sight glass out. Let's see if that will work. A little bit. That's a little too much play. Maybe this, I put this wrench on the side, hoping I might need something thicker. I just had it ready. Let's see. I can't really see if it's popping out. I'm going to get down here and, oh, my thing moved. So just a little patience with this. Try not to damage the inside of the master cylinder. It's a little too much cloth. We're just going to play with it. Right. Get that in there. There we go. Tighten that down and let's see what we can get. I don't think it moved yet. Can you see? Just putting pressure. I don't want to tighten my vise down too much. I don't want to crack the master cylinder. Let's try again. I think we got it. Nada. Nothing yet. I'm just not getting good purchase. It's kind of hard to hold this. I want it to face downwards just for the sake of gravity. Did it move at all? I don't think so. Let's try this again. All right. And then this. Sorry, I keep bumping into you. And then this. Again, I don't want to mar the, there it is. Look at that. Boink. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a cracked sight glass, and it cracked more as it came out. All right. Let's see what this looks like. So, we've got a squashed O-ring in there. We'll pop that out and we'll clean that up a little bit. I want to clean, there's a lot of gunk in there. I'm not sure if you can see it. That's got to be nice and clean. That's all the black crap. Did I say crap? That was coming through this hole when I was trying to bleed it before. I think that's just deteriorated rubber and dirt. All right, I'm going to move you over. Let me grab a couple of other tools and we'll get to cleaning. Just so you can see the cracks in there. visible all over the place. All right, I got my pick. Let's carefully get that O-ring out of there. That was pretty simple. And in here, I don't see any damage. It's a little like, there's black in there. That's old paint. I'm gonna just clean all of that up. You know, I think it's about time. I have a parts washer. I just need to replace the pump on it. I would love to throw this in the parts washer. Another thing I want to make sure that these O-rings match. And what do you know? They do. That's a beautiful thing. Okay. So, I'm going to get a lot of stuff out of here. This is the brake light switch, by the way. It was screwed in the bottom here. I took it out. I don't really need it. The only reason I like it, you hear that? That helps you learn trail braking. Because when you just push the brake lever in, it'll click. And it just gives you the slightest amount of front brake. And you can use that as your indicator to start. Let's do this too. So here's the bad one. Here's the good one. They're the same. The only difference I see is the old one, this metal collar is a little thinner. The new one, it's thicker. Wider, I should say. But by a hair. And I really don't think that will harm anything. Okay. Nice. So, where's my Q-tips? Where's my... Anyway, I'm just cleaning that out a little. I'm gonna get the loose flaky paint off. You don't want any of that in there. And spray a little. I'm gonna use carb cleaner. You could use a brake cleaner. You could also use electronics cleaner, because that's not very harsh at all. Why are you being harsh? Let me get some paper towels. Just want to wipe this down really well. I also want to make sure, we'll get to that though. I want to make sure there are no burrs or anything on the inside of this thing. I'm trying to figure out why exactly the other master cylinder got all chewed up, the seals. Yeah, so there's a lot of loose paint. That was just from my goof with the brake fluid. Now, you know, I should paint this thing, but I kind of just want to get it done. So if I paint it, then I have to let it sit. Should we paint it? What do you think? Should we paint it first? Yeah, look at that. That's not good. You do not at all want to mar the inside face of this, so don't use this like I am. I'm using a very gentle touch. I'm just kind of picking stuff up with it. And then the same thing inside this bore. You do not want any scoring or anything in there. You can. They have these little tiny brushes like you would for a valve guide maybe, or for, you know how when you ream out a cylinder or clean crosshatch a cylinder. I think they have teeny tiny ones for in here too. Similar concept, but I don't have that. Let me set myself up with a couple of other things and then we'll move forward with this. I'm trying to decide if I want to paint. I'm still thinking if I want to paint. In the meantime, a little compressed air. Here's the thing with painting it. It looks shabby right now, right? Definitely. If I paint it though, the paint I'm gonna use is just like a Rust-Oleum black, which means that if I get more brake fluid on here, it'll just take that off too. On the flip side, I can be careful. And maybe it won't look so bad. What would you do? You want to let me know? Write something in the comments. Joke about it with your friends. What do you think? I don't know why there was paint around here. That doesn't make sense to me, because when you close this, you want to have a nice seal. Why have paint there? I don't know. Alright, I can't not paint this. I just can't. What you don't want is to get paint in the bore, in here, right? Or in there, just because you want it to be sealed. I'm going to take the old glass and just kind of temporarily just popped it in there. I'll be able to pop it out by hand again. Maybe I'll put the cap on. And we'll paint that too. Yeah, this thing looks pretty. It needs a little TLC. You cannot paint in there too. This is where it clamps onto the handlebars. It's alright if you do, of course, but you might get better purchase. Ideally, this would be good for powder coat, but that would just take too long right now. That's more than I want to get into. I don't even want to paint. I don't. There, I said it. But I don't want it to look janky. I mean, it's not like the bike doesn't have its issues, you know? But I'm just cleaning loose paint while I'm talking. But at the same time, I don't want it to look like crap, even though it's not Scottish. I'm going to screw that on there because the screw heads, where are you? These should also be black. All right, I'm gonna do it. Something up with the threads in these. All right, let's screw that together. That's good. The temperature in here, 65, right on the borderline of actually that being a decent temperature to spray, but so be it. I'm just putting that on. It'll just make it easier. Not too tight, just enough. All right, let me go get the cap. I got the cap. It's not so bad, but look at this. I don't know if you can you see how it's like like that? So when you put this on here, look what you get. It doesn't seal. That is no good. So I'm going to have to take care of that. I believe we might be able to do a quick and dirty vise repair. It's similar to like a Miami vise repair, just a little different. So, got my aluminum blocks. Don't want any burrs on there. Huh. No wonder. See it right there? Can you make that out? That's cuckoo for frickin' cocoa. Let's see. If I do that. Maybe a little bit. Hang on, I need to find my, I have something I use here to torque on this. Let me go find that. Found it. It's just a piece of pipe I have that fits over the handle. All right, now this is aluminum, so you want to be careful because although it'll bend a little bit, you don't want to crack it. It will release the crack it. Yeah, it'll snap. And I don't know if I can just buy a new cover. Let's see if that did anything. It's still, I can see that it's tweaked. Now mind you, right, you've got your rubber diaphragm and then this plastic piece that sits on top. So you have a little give there, but you still want that thing to be as flat as possible. And it's just definitely not flat there. Huge gap. Another reason that this perhaps wasn't bleeding fully. Every little thing counts. You do want this to be an airtight seal. Let's try that again. Right here. Just gonna mess with it a little bit at a time. It looks flat in the jaws. Huh. Let's see what that did, if anything. It's better. Much better. Can you see that? Still has a little bit, but it's definitely a lot better. Now let's try, just looking at it, this corner is higher than the, these corners. I'm gonna put it in like this now. What I'm doing is, so just so you know, like these are very wide, but the jaws of the chuck, of the vise, I'm sorry, are only about yay. So, I have to only get it like in that area. Makes sense? All right, so let's try it like this. I also don't want to, there's a lip on this, don't want to curl that lip or anything. But we got to do what we got to do. Right. I see it right there. Let me go as deep as I can. And I have good purchase. I think that's good. I believe that'll do. Let's try. What's our success rate, do you think? I don't want to kill it. But I need to give it a little oomph. It's a fine line between giving it enough and it maybe snapping. Steel is malleable. Aluminum, not so much. What do you think? Better. It's definitely better. Still right here, it's tweaked right there. All right, let's try that again. Just want to double check my jaws here. I'm gonna put it in deeper than I did before. Meaning when I just did this short side. Looks flat in the vise. All right, I'm gonna keep playing with this. I'll bring you back when I'm decided that I'm done. Well, I played with it as much as I could. There's a slight twist to it. You can kind of just make it out, but it's definitely a lot better than it was. It's fitting a lot more square when you sit it on top now. There's not a gigantic gap. Still a little one, but I think it's a lot better than it was. And I think with the play you have with the diaphragm and the spacer in there, we'll be okay. All right, I'm gonna paint it at this point. Just throw some paint on it, no need to rush. So let me prep it for paint and bring it back. So I basically threw a piece of tape over the outlet where the banjo bolt will go in. I was gonna just drive a banjo bolt in there, but I want the surface here to remain clean of paint. And then I threw a piece of paper towel inside the bore there. Doesn't matter if this part gets some paint on it at all. And then I put the cap on and have this on, and then the old sight glass just to kind of keep any paint out of there. So we'll just hang it up. And then I've got, I have some Rust-Oleum 2X Ultra Cover paint and primer, dun dun dun, satin black. Back you up a little. Just a change, so I don't try a wound. And I'm just gonna use this old envelope like this to keep a ton of overspray. Actually, I might get something bigger. I'm gonna shake this paint and find something bigger to cover that with. Okay, oh, battery's gonna run out. Just gonna do three quick coats. And then we flip it like that. I just think it's gonna look better than it did. And then we'll be careful when we put more fluid in it. All right, so I just did that coat. I'm gonna let that dry, let it flash off, meaning it's not all shiny. And then I'll do two more coats like that. And I'll let it sit for at least 24 hours, but I probably won't get back to this for another week. So it'll have plenty of time to cure. I'll bring it back when I'm done spraying just so you can see it. So it's the next morning. I'm inside the house now. I sprayed the master cylinder with a couple of coats of that spray paint I showed you. And then I brought it in the house to dry because it's much warmer in here and it'll dry better and bond better. And then it dawned on me this morning that I have this VHT caliper paint. So it's drum and it's chemical resistant. It's also heat resistant, which we don't really need that temperature. But the chemical resistant part is the part I'm interested in. So I mean, it won't completely stop it from messing up if any brake fluid gets on there, but it'll be better than the stuff I have on there now. But this is quite cold because that's been sitting in the garage. So what I've got here is a bowl of water that's hot water, and I'm gonna sit the paint can inside the hot water to let it warm up. This is always a good trick you can do when you're spray painting from a can, especially. Bring it up to temperature at least 70 degrees. I don't know, I'm not a painter, so I can't give you exact temperatures, but this is really cold. My garage is like 50 degrees right now. Also, while we're gonna do this, I'm heating up the garage because I'll be doing the painting in the garage, and then I'll bring it back in the house to dry. But a little trick too, besides the water, so you let it sit in here, you don't want boiling water, you don't want this to explode, okay? That's definitely, this is just hot water from the tap, as hot as it will get. In the past, I've just sat that in the water and then maybe sat something heavy on top of it. What happens though is sometimes the water eats away the label and then you can't read the application, dry times, etc. So what I'm going to do in this case is I have these big freezer Ziploc baggies I get from the dollar store. I'll put the can inside of that and then put that in the water. And that should help keep the label from getting chewed away. Because, you know, if you want to use this can a few months down the road, you won't remember. I mean, shit, I forgot that I had this can. Oh, good, it's sitting. There's enough paint in it. So, yeah, I'm just going to let that sit there. Pardon me. For a little while, at least 15 minutes. The can is so cold, actually. I don't know how much it'll cool the water down, so I may just end up adding some more hot water again. But you see what I'm doing there. So, warm that up. Warm up the part, which it's already warm. It's inside the house. I'm warming up the garage. Then a couple coats of this stuff on top of what I've already done. No big deal. Don't tell anybody. All right. We're not perfect. That's just how it is sometimes. Okay. Just wanted to let you know that and see this painting tip. All right. I'll see you in a while. All right. Here we are. Paint's warmed up. Garage is somewhat warmed up. Parts warmed up. I'm just going to do two thin coats. The paint I put on last night is still a little tacky, so I don't know if I'm going to have a bad reaction. I may just be creating a monster here. But we'll see. We'll see what happens. Again, this isn't like a too crucial a thing. It was just more so it doesn't look completely horrendous. I know I may block you. Just deal with it. Thin coats are better than thick coats. Except in the Arctic. Whatever. It's hard to see where I've painted and haven't, just because of the same color. Okay, that's got to sit for 10 minutes. While it's waiting, I'm bringing the paint back inside so it'll stay warm. And then I'll come back and do one more coat. See you in a bit. All right, folks, here we are. It's a week later. Here is my doubly painted master cylinder. Came out nice, actually. I like it. I'm expecting the paint to come off of the hardware. And hopefully I don't spill too much fluid on this thing and make it look messy again. Anyway, not too bad. Let's take this apart. I'll take these off. Looks better than it did, at the very least, right? I left it in the house for the week, just hanging in my spare bathroom, so it would stay warm. And it did. It seems to have dried pretty well. Like you can see, for example, under where the hardware was, there's not any paint, but it's really okay. I wasn't looking for a show finish. Let's get the top off here. And the top seems to have straightened out pretty dang well compared to how it was. There's still a bit, but it's nowhere near as bad as it was. Now, the paint I used the second time, that brake caliper paint, It's because it's good for heat as well. It wouldn't have hurt if I stuck this like in front of the propane heater for a little while, just kind of bake that paint on, but it doesn't really matter. Oh, I expected this paint to come off, but it did not. That's good. My goodness, not only is my bench incredibly messy, I really need to straighten this up as well as my garage. Okay, there we go. Not bad. Not bad at all. And we'll pop out the old sight glass. There you have it. Okay. So I think the first thing I'd like to do, pardon me, is put in the new sight glass. That'll require getting any debris out of this area here, because that's where the O-ring is going to sit. So you want a nice clean inside there. Take some paper towel, or maybe even some Q-tip or something. Now, although that caliper paint said it's chemical resistant, you still don't want to just spray this with carb cleaner or something, or brake fluid, you know, just to be on the safe side. Q-tip action. It's not just for your ears. All right, I'm happy with that. I want to get any stuff out of here too. Oh, let's get the, I forgot we had tape over that. Nice, I like that. And then we had this little piece of paper shoved in here. Let's get that out. All right, that looks good. I'm happy with that. Nice and clean. Yeah, I don't see any residue in there. No paint got in there, that's good. A little bit of paint right here. Right in there, but that's totally okay. All right, pardon me. Let's install this doobobber. So we've got the new O-ring. Make sure it's clean. I'm not gonna use any type of lubricant or anything. It wouldn't, I could put a teeny tiny bit of brake fluid on there, but I'm not going to. Just wanna get it into place. Make sure it's seated, no debris on it. And I think I mentioned, like in research I did, it looks like this size is just very common to all sorts of motorcycles. So what ends up happening is this ring, this metal ring, is going to seal against the inside here. That's why you want that to be as clean as possible. You would like it to start as straight as you can without it being cockeyed. I just put it in cockeyed. That's why I got four of them. Yeah, it was just a finger tight. So, just want to kind of get it just where it's started. All right, now I'm going to use a clamp, a seat clamp, like this. And I would like to take, I have a old piece of belt here. I'm just gonna cut a slice off of it. Can you see what I'm doing? Just slicing that up. Nothing fancy. Because I want to put that on the inside where the seat clamp is going to go on the inside of here. And I want to find a flat piece of metal, something hard, to clamp onto this metal ring here. Let me take a quick peek and see what I can come up with. So I found this eighth inch, a little less than eighth inch piece of steel I had cut off of some other project. I'm gonna cut just a little bit more off of that right there. Careful not to get my fingers. I just don't want, this is aluminium, I don't want anything to, I don't want to mar the inside of that. See what I'm saying? Alright, let's bring you a little closer to the edge of the table. And start screwing that in. And put that in place. There we go. Trying not to scratch my fancy new paint job. And I want to center it right over that sight glass. And ever so slowly screw that in. It is a little cockeyed. And my piece of metal was binding. So I've seen people try and put these in, hammering them into place. However, it's cracked the glass, so you're kind of defeating the purpose. Let's try this again. Three hands would be nice. Oh, again, a little cockeyed. Also a little cockeyed. I'm not sure why that's happening. Let's see if I can rectify that. Perhaps my vise will come in handy now. I got this vise in Miami back in the 90s. That's not true. Alright, first a dirty rag. Next this, and then just enough to hold it, which it's not doing. Just have my hands free. I'm gonna try a C-clamp that has a bigger footprint on that part. Maybe that'll help. Let's close that up a bit. Alright. And then this, I don't want it for it to touch the, it's pivoting that way. I mean, that the foot of the clamp does pivot, so that kind of makes sense, but the problem is trying to line it up enough to where it doesn't do that while holding the thing, while having the metal not scratch, while lining this all up. Come on, honey. You can do it. You know you wanna. Yeah, it's still going. Oh, there it is. It popped right in. Let's double check it though. Let's make sure nothing is amiss or a mister. It's in. It did not crack. There's a little bit of this acrylic. It looks like the O-ring seated. I think I'd like it to pop in just a little bit more, just a tiny bit, just to make sure it's as far in as it needs to go. But can you see that? It's standing just a teeny bit proud, but I think it's okay. That was weird. It was going in all crooked like, and then pop. I kind of forced it. I won't lie. Don't hold it against me. Just start with that. Kind of held in place again. Kind of, sort of. Because I don't need too much now. And then here's this. And then here's that. Let's unscrew that. And put this in. And screw that down. Without dropping anything. You with me? And now I want to get it centered right over the sight glass. There it is. And I'm just screwing it down as snugly as I can until it bottoms out, which it should. I think that's about it right there. There's a little give on this side because of the leather, but that should do it. There we go. I don't want to overdo it either, but I think that is where it would need to be. All right. There we go. All right, let's back this puppy out and see what we've got. There it is. It's not really sitting proud anymore. I've humbled it. It's all even right around there. Right there. It's a little bit, teeniest tiny bit proud. I think I'm gonna squash it down a little more. Just to make sure, but that's basically, you get the idea. So a little patience, a little lining stuff up, a little getting everything into place, but your biggest concern is that the O-ring is seated properly and this is flat. You haven't cracked it. I think that'll do us well. All right, I'll bring you back in a little bit and we'll move forward with the rebuild. All right, here we go. So I pushed it in. It's now as deep in the socket as it can go. Again, just making sure everything's fine. I don't see any problems. I have to tell you, there's something, it eases your stress when you have extra parts in case you mess one up. You know what I mean? Thankfully, it seems fine. So now what we want to do is put together and install the new master cylinder rebuild kit. So here's the old one, and again, you can see here, like, these washers are just worn out, rubbed out, chewed up. So let's open up the new one. By the way, it's really cold right now in where I live in New Mexico. Not freezing or anything, but it's colder than usual, and my propane heater just ran out. Woo! So here's what we've got. We've got the new piston. Let's make sure it matches the old piston. You need the diameters to be correct. That's got the letter A on it. This does not. So we don't know what letter this is. Anyway, the diameters look pretty dang close. I can also make sure just by pushing it into the bore. And you want to be real careful with this bore. You don't want to mar it, scratch it, anything. I was making sure there were no burrs in there, which caused the chewing up of this. I don't know if somebody possibly stuck something sharp in here, which you shouldn't do. You also want to make sure that you can look through You can shine a light through this bore here and make sure you see light coming out of the holes. I don't know if you can make that out in camera. Let me shut this light off. That means they're not clogged. Can you see that? All right. So that's a good way. I think I'll just keep that light off. All right. So what we've got is the piston, a new spring, which sits right on the end of the piston like that. The large end goes that way. This is going to slide inside. Prior to doing that, we've got a small, sometimes these are called top hat washers, they're seals. You can see they have a groove or a, like they're U-shaped. That's always towards the side of the pressure that it's, you want it to push. This is a new top hat. When this is sticking out from the master cylinder, you just pop that on, and a new circlip. So if you look too, these have different diameters. That's got a smaller and that's got a larger diameter. So you would assume the smaller diameter one goes here where the piston is narrower, and the larger diameter one goes there. So let's get this one on first. You can go that way or the other way. I believe it's kind of six of one, half dozen of the other. You just want to be really careful not to tear them, etc. It's a little tricky. Heating them up can help. Don't use anything sharp at all. Sometimes you may have to, but you have to be super careful. My battery's about to die, but I think we can get this done before that. There we go. I'm trying to feed it over. This is going to be tough. Let me see if I can find a little wooden dowel or something. I'll be right back. All right, so I got this little zip tie. If you notice, one side has these ridges and one side's smooth. So I'm going to use the smooth side. And then I'm going to take just a dab of brake fluid. Just a dab. Just a little bit. Just going to coat the inside of this so it's just a little more slippery. And I'm going to actually, I'm going to put that one on from this side. So now let's match these up, right? And the channel goes that way. So let's get that on there. Again, smooth side against the thing. And then a little pulling with the zip tie and pushing with my finger. Carefully, fingernails, just careful. Don't overstretch it. You know, just a little bit at a time. And there we go. Now listen. You hear that? That was the teeth rubbing against the metal here. So you didn't want that against the rubber because it could cut it or chew it up. And now we're going to do the same thing with this one. Just a little smidge of brake fluid. And this one, I might just be able to... maybe not. Why not use our tool? Okay. Is that clean? Yes. I'm just making sure it was clean. Dirty. And again, orienting it the right way. Putting it on. Slowly feeding it around. That was it. That one was much easier. All right. So there you have it. There's those two. They're on. They're facing the right way. They're not torn. So that's nice. Next, the spring. It just kind of fits right over the end of that. Next, we'll have our, remember, our handy master cylinder circlip. Pliers, or C-clip pliers, or E-clip pliers, or whatever kind of clip you want, right? They just have a longer reach and are skinnier here, so you can get inside of there. Now, I don't want to get brake fluid on my fresh paint. What I do want to do, one last check, make sure this is clean. No particles, paint, debris, sharp edges. Looks fine. You see anything in there? Again, I'm going to take just a little, whatever brake fluid's on there for the exterior of these now. And it'll help it slide. And then we prepare this. Remember now, there's always a flat side. That's this side. And there's a rounded side. I don't know if you can see that. The flat side is pointing down right now. And that's the side you want against the body of the master cylinder. Let me get any excess brake fluid off my fingers before I start grabbing my master cylinder. Now this too, so now I have to recess this, push it in to get that clip in. I'm also feeling for how the new seals went in, and they went in very nice, tight enough to make a good seal, but not so tight that they wouldn't move well. I'm gonna use my tools to help me. I know that's filthy, but I'm okay with that. Let's put this down here. Just enough to hold it in place. Alright. We'll get our circlip ready. Flat side down. Our tool here. Get it in place. And this thing is a little bit spring-loaded, so you hope you can do that, right? Now, let's push down, feed that in, start closing that, and then push that down all the way. Come on, honey. All right, it looks like it's in. Just to make sure, I will use my pick tool. You could use a screwdriver and just push down, see if it's clipped into place, because you definitely don't want that popping out. You got to make sure it's seated. It's not seated in the groove. Oh, I have the flashlight in my mouth. I'm going to grab it again. Squeeze it. Push down carefully. You can also use a thin screwdriver, which may actually be better. Now I think it's in there. Let me grab my screwdriver. Let's see. All right, let's activate that. And that's another reason you want a little bit of brake fluid on there so you can make sure it's working and in place without it binding. And then finally, I'm going to push this down with the flashlight in my mouth so I can't talk. Push that down and give a little nudge to the clip. Make sure it's in place all the way. Yep. It's in there. Nice. Another way to tell, when I pushed that down, I rotated the clip ever so slightly and it spun around rather than popping out. So that's good. Finally, we have our little top hat. Now, that's kind of got to sit inside. Let's see if I can zoom you in a little bit. It's got to sit inside there, this bottom part. inside there. And then this top part, there's a little ridge cutout. I'll show you on the piston. See right here, this little right there, focus please. All right, come on honey, you gotta talk nicely. It's right there. Okay, so the inside lip of that, you want to go in there. I think I'm gonna take a Q-tip, pulling the cotton off of it. I'm gonna use that as a pusher. There we go. So I'm pushing it so it sits inside of that opening. It's not quite stable enough, sturdy enough, but it's good enough to get it started at least. And then careful not to cut that with your fingernails. It's partially in. There it is. That popped in. Can you see how that's nice and folded over there? Right? So that means that lip is inside. And then the bottom part, let's see if I can get you to see inside there. The bottom lip, it's not quite in all the way. So I need something a little sturdier. I have this super cheap pair of forceps. This is not sharp, at least relatively speaking. And it's thin enough, kind of pop in there. Little flashlight action, just ever so carefully. Not the end of the world, but you just want it to stay put as that's moving. There we go. All right. So now we have a relatively freshly painted with a new sight glass and rebuilt piston and seals master cylinder. Not so hard, right? Okay, next step is start mounting things on the bike and bleeding the brake lines again. Let's set you up for that. Okay, so that's done. Took a while, just so you know, things take a while sometimes. It's actually the next day. Everything's snugged up. I've tightened this banjo fitting and I used my torque wrench, 18 foot-pounds in the manual. Again, link for the manual down below. Next step, fill that puppy with fluid, and then first we drain the master cylinder. First we bleed the master cylinder. Okay, my big concern is not getting fluid all over my fresh paint job. That's why I took the my number plate off so I'd have better access. So I fill that up, and what you want to do is very slowly you pull in. Let's see if you can see that. You're gonna see bubbles. There's one floating. Do you see here? Here we go. There you are. You see the two holes at the bottom of the reservoir? One's a feed, one's a return. I mentioned that, I think, in video number one. Basically, when you pump the lever, those two seals we put on, one will push that way, allowing it to feed from the hole, and then the other one, when you release, it'll let the fluid come back up the other hole. As you slowly pull in the brake lever, which you can't quite see me do, you're gonna see bubbles slowly coming up out of there. You see that? That is the air that's inside the master cylinder here where we put in that new piston. So now you don't want to push this in too much or too quickly, because when that air is all gone, it's gonna squirt out of there and get all over the freaking place. Also, I've turned the bars so that the master cylinder is now more parallel to the ground. Okay, so that's a good sign. Another thing you can do is tap on the brake line right near the master cylinder with a wrench or something to dislodge any air that's in there. Okay, this is good. Oh. And we got that one from there, the return. Also, the fluid level is going down a little by little. All right, that's good. It's getting less. I'm making sure to allow the lever to do its full range of motion. Let me just do a real quick check here with my finger. Here, I'll let you see what I'm doing now. You've seen the bubbles, you understand the process. What I'm just doing now is running my finger under the connector here, make sure there's no fluid, which there is not. All right, I'm just holding this rag handy. All right, that's good. Oh, there we go. Another thing you can do is kind of let go of the, pull the lever in slightly, and then let go. Sometimes that jarring action will dislodge some bubbles. There's some teeny, teeny, tiny bubbles still coming up. Not sure if you can see that. Grab this wrench. I'm risking, but I'm tapping on the hose up towards the where it bolts into the master cylinder as I'm working the lever. Sometimes these teeny, teeny, tiny air bubbles will get trapped in there, and that you have to get rid of all of them. You can't have like just a little bit of air. You want. Sorry, SD card filled up. All I was saying was I was tapping on that line, and you want to get all the air out of there. You don't even want just a teeny bit of air in there. That will make your brakes feel spongy always. This can take some time, right? So now as I'm pulling this lever in, I'm seeing a little bit of fluid rather than bubbles. I hope you can see that. Right over here, I need a pointer of some sort. This second hole here, it pushes the fluid up rather than bubbles coming out of there. Can you see that? See that? That's fluid pushing up. So that's telling me this is close to being full. So now that should be pushing some fluid down into the brake line itself and then down to the caliper. So I'm going to start bleeding at the caliper now. Here's my MityVac. It's mighty. And it vacs. I'm pumping that up a bit. I still have no stiffness at the brake lever, but I'm gonna hold it in anyway, because that's the way you would bleed the brakes normally. And with the brake lever held in, I'm gonna loosen this. Now watch, there's some fluid in there already. It should start coming through. Bubbles, air, and fluid. See that? Then I'm going to close the brake line, the brake bleeder, and then let go of the brake lever and pump that some more. And I see I'm getting more pressure at the top in regards to the fluid pushing up through that hole. So let's do that again. My MityVac still has, I don't know if you can see that in the shot. I know you can see it, but I don't know if you can see the needle. My MityVac still has some pressure built up. So I'm gonna crack this open, watching that while at the same time keeping an eye at the fluid level in the master cylinder so I don't overdo it. Right, and then I'm gonna pump the brakes at the master cylinder again. And remember, we're not only filling the brake line, we have to fill the cavities in here behind the pistons. So that's important. And I'm just going to keep repeating this process over and over again, pumping the master cylinder, the brake lever, to make sure I still get a little bit of air bubbles coming out of there. So, you know, still doing that. And then filling the master cylinder as it gets lower, holding the brake line down, cracking open the bleeder screw with the MityVac sucking on it, getting air and fluid out of there until eventually you get no air, all fluid, and a stiff brake lever. All right, I'm just gonna keep playing with that and then I'll bring you back when I'm done. If you have any questions, just ask me down below in the comments and I'll let you know. Okay, hang on and you'll be back soon, I hope. All right, after much futzing, pumping and then bleeding down below, I've got it stiffened up. One thing to note, and I just discovered this myself, I had these are adjustable levers. Right now it's at its furthest most position out from the bars. I had it down to the closest position, so when you get to the bottom of the throw, it's a little squishy there, and you have a whole lot of extra leverage as well, so it feels like it's not very stiff. And also, as I was pumping this and holding it down and then cracking open the bleeder screw, it only had this much room to travel, the handle, to push that much fluid out. And then I realized my mistake, so I clicked this all the way out. And now I pumped it to there and it stiffens up. And then when I cracked open the bleeder screw, there was this much more room to travel. Makes sense? All right, so that's the front. One thing I'd like to do is overnight, I'm gonna hold that down and throw a zip tie around it. And that, I think I have just a little bit of air left in my master cylinder up top. So this is one trick to bleeding it. So just let it sit like that, careful, because that will break away. It's designed to do that. You also don't want to cut into your grips too much. So now I have that on, I'm gonna let that sit overnight with the cover on. I have the cover screwed down. I did spill a little on my fresh paint job. I'm pretty pissed off about it, but it is what it is. All right, so that's the front. Like I said, gonna let that sit overnight. I don't have time to do the back tonight, so I'll get to that ASAP, and then we'll call this baby done. It's the next morning. I want to see if my little zip tie jammy jam did anything. Let's see. Yeah, feels pretty good in the fully out position. My concern is bringing this in a little. Oh, that feels good. Well, my YouTuber friends, about a week later, I'm still working on this bike. Should have taken 2 hours. It's been several weeks, but that's just how it is sometimes. I am so ready to get done. I just wanted to show you, front brakes are working great. Nice and stiff, nice and firm, but there's one last thing we have to do to finish the front brakes, and that is install the breather dust shield. It just kind of keeps it protected from crud getting in there. All right, there we go, there it is, and spoop, done. All right, let's get the back done, and we're done, and then we're done. All right, working on the back, it's gonna be just like working on the front in regards to installing the brake line, bleeding the brakes, etc. But I figured I would just run you through it. We might encounter a couple of different things that you might like to know. First thing is getting the fluid out of the rear master cylinder. I don't remember, I may have done that, it's been so long. One thing, hold on to it here firmly and then unscrew the cap, because it's just held on by this little plastic tab that juts out of the master cylinder, and you can snap that off. Oh, I guess I already emptied that. Would you look at me? Aren't I the most specialist man on the planet? All right, so now we are going to suck any fluid in the brake line out of the brake line. I like how I said that. So there's the brake line. Once again, I will use my mightiest of vacs. By the way, this spins so you can see. We do have a rubber dust shield on here too. I'm going to pop that off. Just remove it, put it to the side. Speak nicely to it. All right, pardon me, choking. And I'm just gonna run the hose on the end. The MityVac does come with fittings. She showed you, I believe, that can sit over the end, but this works easier sometimes. Now we are pumping, pumping, pumping. This is just to get the fluid out of the brake line itself. I honestly don't remember if I did this already. So let's crack that puppy open. You might see the needle going down as it sucks any fluid out. Here comes the fluid. Can you see it? It's like glug 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 glug. I'm gonna hold the MityVac lower. Ooh. It's singing. That's it sucking. Needle's going down. It's sucking the fluid through the line, and you can hear it coming out of the master cylinder. Or the reservoir, I should say. I'm going to snug that up just a bit and try one more time. This time I'm going to depress the brake lever as I loosen the bleeder screw. So I'm pumping that up. Just want you to see that. I'm going to put it down on the ground. I don't know if you'll see it now. I am depressing. This hand is going to the brake lever. Okay, here you go. I am depressing the brake lever. And then I am loosening the bleeder screw. And maybe whatever lasts. You hear that? It's like, ah, it's like drinking the last bits of your milkshake. All right, so again, be careful here. You don't want to get any of this fluid on your brake pads. I happen to have almost brand new brake pads on the back. I did put them in before the last time I went to the track, so they have been used a little bit, but they're still relatively new. That's that. I've got the fluid out of the line, and now we can carefully take the old brake line off. Okay, so remove that, wipe up any excess, not the band in excess, but any excess, whatever. That was just a bad joke. 14 millimeter. Well, this might be smaller actually. Yes, I'm sorry, wrong size. Let me get the right size. All right, it's a 12 millimeter. 14 is the size of the new banjo bolt heads. The threads, the diameter of the bolt part with the threads and the thread pitch are the right size, the same size. It's just that the heads are different sizes. Can you see? Bring it a little closer. The lighting's a little weird, isn't it? I apologize. I'm going to take this one out first because when I undo it, it'll be lower than the one ahead of it by the reservoir, so any residual fluid may can, which I'm already seeing, can come out of it. I also want to keep in mind the orientation of the fittings, because the new brake line, we're going to probably have to spin the fittings like we did on the front one to get them in place. So see that curve right there too? There's a spring on there. I'm not sure if I need to try and get that spring on the new line. The new line did come with two rubber grommets. If you look in here, let me get you off the tripod to show you. So over here, this spring, it just kind of helps this keep its orientation, as well as from any chafing, or if it rubs or hits anything, rather than cutting through the line, right? And then you see we've got right here, and then there's another one ahead of it right there. It's a little dark, I apologize. Where the line goes through, the new line has two rubber bushings that I think would sit inside of there. We'll see about the spring in a moment. Okay, so the front, the back one's off. Let's get the front one off. Bring it closer just so you can see. But it's pretty straightforward. Right, it's right there. I'm just unscrewing them. That's all. It's chilly. We had not a lot of snow a few days ago, but it's just bitterly cold here in New Mexico. And the roads froze. They were like an ice skating rink. I ended up having to ditch my car on the side of the road and walk 3 miles at like 2 o'clock in the morning to get home after work. That was fun. And I thought I'd be riding my motorcycle yesterday, my Royal Enfield. That didn't happen. Okay, front one's off. Just wiping down any excess. Two, with this new line, I can orient the fitting. I don't know, for anyone that maybe saw my video on me installing these rear sets, the front fitting here, I'll show you in a moment when I can get it out. There we go. You see how this, where are you? Sorry. See how that goes zoop up? That's the up sound. Zoop is the down sound, but this goes zoop. Well, it kind of came up from the master cylinder, the plunger, and then back down, and it made it a little taut. It was a little strange. So we'll see if we can orient the new fitting to go in the right direction. And then this one has this little protrusion, which actually sits in between these two shoulders here. To keep it from turning. The new one, I believe, does not have that. Why don't I go grab it and we'll take a look and we'll figure it out together. All right, so here's the old line and the new one. This is the side that went into the top of the plunger by the rear brake line. I would say that those two fittings are those. So this is the front of my line. But now if you see this one, kind of curves zoop, up curve sound, right? This one goes zoop, down curve sound. So I have an option here. Well, if you notice too, like I said, protrusion, this is the one that matches. They both have a similar, where are you? Downward angle. Can you see that? But this one has no protrusion. That's fine. That's not a problem. What I think I'd like to do, however, I need to spin one of these. So this is sort of in the orientation we want already because of that downward curve in that direction, right? I guess it would be if you went from this side. But this one, you'd think I'd have to spin it because the stock one goes up, but I want it to go down like that, because it'll have a much nicer line from here going down and then around. Okay, so at the moment I'm still not sure if I need to take that spring off of the original one, but here are those rubber bushings or bumpers I told you about. Let's see what happens if I leave things the way they are without putting in the spring. See if I like it. So we're through the first, I'm feeding the rubber bumpers through. Let's see if you can see better. I know it's a little dark, I'm sorry. I don't have that much light on this side. So right here, I'm feeding that bumper through. Right here. That's the first one that should go in front. Sounds like there's some action outside. My neighbor's kids. Somebody egged our neighborhood the other day. Not just by my house, but like the whole neighborhood. All right, so that's through. That's through. Let me temporarily, I will temporarily screw the banjo bolt into the plunger right there, just to hold it in place. My copper washer's oxidized a little. And remember, these, there's a flat side and a rounded side. The flat sides are gonna sandwich the banjo fitting. Sandwich. Right, so the bolt's gonna go like that. The round part is going up, flat part down. Flat part down against the fitting, straight down, and then this one, flat part up towards the fitting. There you go. And just a quick snuggy snug, just to kind of hold it there so it's not fighting us. Tell you right now, I already like how that swoops down there. We do have to be careful about the line hitting the pipe. Okay, so I'm moving that rubber bumper forward and trying to get squeeze it into. All right, that's good. I don't know what's going to keep that from vibrating itself down the line, because it's not like it snaps into place. I'm pushing this one into place now. So I got the front one in place. Yeah, I'm just pushing it now. It's where it needs to be. But I can't see how with vibration that won't move. What I might end up doing, we'll see, get a couple of thin black zip ties, put one on either side of the bumper. Okay, so now that's going to come over. And I'm gonna have to spin, man, these are nice and loose enough to do it by hand. I just spun that banjo fitting a little. I got this line an inch longer too than stock, I mentioned, because of how it meets up with the plunger in front, and it gives me a nice amount of play right there. So, to spring or not to spring? That is the question. Let's let me do the same thing here. I'm just gonna kinda pop the bolt through the fitting. Pardon me. Still getting over being sick. Alright. Now again, remember, it doesn't have that protrusion, which is perfectly fine. The only thing we have to make sure is when this gets tightened down, when we're getting ready to snug everything up and then start bleeding it, that the banjo bolt doesn't, fitting doesn't spin too much when we torque it down. That does tend to happen a lot of times. I hope I'm not blocking you. I'm just having a hard time getting that in the right orientation so that the bolt just screws right in without any interference. You definitely don't want to strip that out, especially because it's gold. Come on, honey. Yep. There we go. Can you see what I'm doing? Again, it's dark. My apologies. Use the force, Luke. All right. So I'm getting a really big hump right here. And again, that is... Oh, no. My mistake. Sorry, children's. Taking it back out. We got to spin that 180 degrees. So it's downwards. Maybe that's why it was fighting me. It was trying to tell me something. See? You see? So, 180. I like that better. And mind you too, even if everything is the exact right length, because these are steel braided, they're not quite as flexible. So you do have to kind of put them where you need them to be. Does that make sense? All right. Let's see if you can see what's going on. One moment, please. So, lines come in here, right, through, up to the top. I'm just kind of eyeballing where everything's sitting. At the moment, this is away from the pipe. That's good. I can always push that inboard just a little bit when I snug it down. Over here is the side that would have had the spring. Do I want the spring? I don't know. I don't even know. I don't know. What do you think? To spring or not to spring? It'd be too bad. It's shorter than this, because the spring had this little extra collar here holding it in place. I'd have to kind of spread the spring apart and feed it around the line. I don't think that'll happen. All right, we're gonna leave it as is. Let's show you. Let me take you off the stand. Hang on. All right, so here we come here. There's space to get to the bleeder. It's a little bit blocked on this side, but not too bad. We got this nice curve. It's not kinked. It's coming across, across here, up here. We do not want it to touch the pipe at all. You don't want it to bind up, because remember, the swing arm here will be moving up and down as the shock engages. So you need room for it to do that. It's touching here, but that's not the end of the world at all. By the way, I popped that back in just to be safe, that no crud gets in there. So I'm gonna mull on this for a little bit and decide where I want it. Tighten everything down. I will torque the fittings down. I believe it off the top of my head, 18 foot-pounds. It's in the manual. Description below is the link for the manual. I keep mentioning that. All right, I'll bring you back in a few. All right, so I have both fittings torqued down. And what I did here, I spun that that there, that hose clamp, was turned to the left a little bit, and it was just kind of close to the brake line, so I just spun it so the sharp bits are away, and then I pushed the line inbound. It's just about touching this hose, and this pivots here, so I pivoted that in a little, pushed the hose in a little. Nothing is crimped, nothing is kinked. The reason I did that is now, here's the line and everything's black. It could be none more black, really, and it's hard to see. So I did that because now it kind of has the tendency to want to be in that direction, inbound, and that will keep it away from the exhaust pipe. So when the swing arm goes up and down, this will move up and down with it as well, but it should not come outbound and touch the exhaust. So that's good. And then this side, I torque that down, and what I used as my metric is partially, I didn't want this too far out, so as this goes up and down, it won't hit the pipe. Also, I wanted to be able to get the box end of a wrench on there, and I can just kind of get that on there as it hits there. All right, so I'm happy with that. These rubber bumper thingies, I'm glad they're there, but again, this one here, can you see? Right there. Pretend that you can't play along. This one slides. It can't really slide through because the shoulder of the rubber bumper is bigger than the gap, but I still may, I don't know if I have any right now. I'll just have to go get some really thin black zip ties and just kind of zip tie it in place on this one too, just so they don't move. Okay. All right. Next step, fill it with fluid, start bleeding. All right, I shed a little light on this situation. I have this flashlight. Hopefully the batteries don't run out. First step is to fill this puppy. Eat your puppy. It's not a kitten. I sure hope I have room. I don't want to spill this stuff everywhere. So I think I can sneak it in from the opposite side. Let's see. Let's see if I can do that. Thankfully, at least here, there's not like a freshly painted master cylinder. Right? Can I do it? No. Oh, just. You hear that? That's air. So that's it. Going from there down this, the tube. No, not the British Railway system. This tube that goes down into the master cylinder. So I have it to the upper line. I'm not going to go much higher. And now, allow me to zoom you in. And what I'm doing, maybe you need to see that. I'm still trying to get good at this, folks. I'm pumping the rear brake lever. What I'm trying to see, as I'm going to keep pumping that lever, I want you to see, are there any bubbles coming through, coming up? In the manual, it tells you it's the same bleeding procedure as for the front. I don't believe that. What I want to make sure too is there are no leaks anywhere. Right? Everything is as it should be. I'm pumping that. I don't see any movement. I don't see any bubbles coming out of there. Oh, you know what I forgot to do? I think we can still get away with it. I want to take out that, just to be on the safe side, this bleeder screw here, and just to make sure it's clear. You think it's going to start pouring fluid? I don't. Let's see. It is air. Air and fluid. Well, that's a good sign. Actually, that means I don't have to clean it. All right. So let's start bleeding this puppy. We're gonna go back to the use of the MityVac, right? I'm gonna hook it up. I will pump it up. I will bleed it out. But first, I will change my battery. Okay, so here's what I'm gonna do. Let me tell you what I'm gonna do. I'm pumping the vac, right? They say about 10 to 15 pumps. I'm just gonna crack that bleeder screw open. I'm not gonna touch the brake pedal. Just cracking that open to see what it does. There's definitely air coming through, of course. I'm also keeping an eye, so the fluid in the master cylinder is now going down. You don't want to go so low that you introduce air back into the system. Make sense? Because then you're just kind of defeating the purpose. All right, and we'll do it again. We're pumping the mightiest of vacs. Let me add a little more brake fluid. Hopefully we have no surprises like we did with the front one. Okay, MityVac is pumped and I'm cracking open the bleeder. Fluid is coming out. I'm looking at the master cylinder. The level is going down. I see little air bubbles coming out of the bleeder. I'm gonna tighten this when it gets to the lower mark on the master cylinder, just to be on the safe side. If you notice, I'm not using the box end because it's ratcheting. I'd have to pull the tube every time. Makes sense. Let me hit the brake pedal. Ooh, we have brakes. Ha ha! How fast and easy was that? That's just beautiful. I'm gonna do it a few more times, but I have brakes. Super easy. So it's literally like 60 seconds later. I did that bleeding process two more times and this thing is just perfect. There's no squishiness. The brake engages in a good spot and it just locks it right up. I let the level drain down to this top line right here. That's the high mark. The reason for that is when we put the cover on, you don't want it to overflow. Make sure your cover is clean of debris, hair, dog food, cat particles, rocks. Okay, so according to the manual, you put that on, you snug it down, and then again, because that can snap, you hold on to it, and you give it another eighth to a quarter of a turn. And that's it. Ooh, that's even better. It firmed it up even more. Ha, that's beautiful. See how easy that was? The front could have been that easy. I mean, don't get me wrong. I'm glad we found all the issues and we fixed them. It was just, I just want you to, that's a perfect indicator basically that sometimes things go smoothly and sometimes things don't. And you just kind of work through them and around them until you get it where it needs to be. So why am I pointing you down? Because of the dust cap. Hello, dust cap. It's not, you know, if you don't have a dust cap on there, it's not gonna like destroy anything, but it just keeps it, any stuff from clogging in there. So when you do wanna bleed your brakes, you don't have to worry about it being plugged as well as maybe possibly sucking that dirt into the line. I just want you to see. There we go. All right, capped from dust. And what the final thing I want to do, I found some itsy bitsy baby zip ties of the appropriate color so they can go here. So basically, I'll show you on this one just so you see what I'm doing. Zoom in. I need like an editing and filming team. What's up? It's dark, huh? I don't know if I can. That's not helping at all. There we go. Right there. Does that help at all? A little bit. Basically, I'm taking a zip tie and I'm putting it, gonna put it on either side of that rubber bumper grommet thingy, and just gonna snug it up. Gonna use my linesman's pliers to grab it and just pull tightly. It broke on its own, so I don't have to snip it, clip it. All right, see what I did there? And then I'm gonna do that again on this side of it, and then do it to the other bumper that's in there to keep that from sliding. Let me do that. Give me a moment. Well, I'm very happy to say it is done. Yes, finally. Took quite a while. I mean, not for you guys, but for me, guys, it sure did. But we now have awesome steel braided brake lines with beautiful fittings, fresh brake fluid, right? Really good looking stuff. I can't say enough good things about Core Moto and their brake lines. It's just really beautiful. All right. So folks, thank you so much for watching and sticking with me, and for subscribing. If you haven't already, please do. And also please click that thumbs up button, because then it'll share these videos with other people and more people will see what's going on here. And if you have any comments whatsoever regarding what I've done, if you have any questions or have any suggestions, anything along those lines, please do feel free to comment, because ultimately I'm doing this for fun and I hope you're having fun while we're doing it together. And I want to make this as enjoyable as I can for everybody while doing my thing. All right, thanks for keeping me company. More work getting ready for this bike for the track season. It is now February 2022. Track season starts in May. Got a few more things up my sleeve for this bike, all right? And also for that, I plan on racing that this year. I sure hope I can. Okay, folks, again, thank you. Take care and talk to you soon. Bye.